Welcome to Hackney's ceremony for Holocaust Memorial Day 2021. We are honored by your participation. Together, we will mark this solemn occasion by remembering the horror of the past for a purpose, mindful of the challenges of the present and in the future. Although online, we stand together to remember the importance of this day in all our lives. We will take a pause to reflect on the past and the challenges of our present and future. We remember the past for a purpose and reflect on our own responsibilities as local politicians, as faith leaders, as representatives of organizations, and as individuals with choices over how we react and how we relate to others in our community.
Holocaust Memorial Day encourages remembrance in a world scarred by genocide. We unite across the UK to promote and support the International Day on the 27th of January to remember the 6 million Jews murdered during the Holocaust. We remember the millions of other people killed under Nazi persecution and in subsequent genocides in Cambodia, Rwanda, Bosnia and Darfur. Be the light in the darkness is the theme for Holocaust Memorial Day in 2021. This encourages everyone to reflect on the depths humanity can sink to, but also the ways individuals and communities resisted that darkness to be the light before, during and after the genocide. Be the light in the darkness is an affirmation and a call to action for everyone marking Holocaust Memorial Day. This theme asks us to consider different kinds of darkness. For example, identity-based persecution, misinformation, denial of justice, and also different ways of being the light. For example, resistance, acts of solidarity, rescue, and illuminating mistruths. Increasing levels of denial, division, and misinformation in today's world we must be vigilant against hatred and hostility. Rapid technological developments, a turbulent political climate, and world events beyond our control can leave us feeling helpless and insignificant. The unprecedented times through which we are currently living are showing the very best of what humanity is capable of, but also in some of the abuse and conspiracy theories being spread on social media, that much darker side of our world as well. We can all stand in solidarity. We can choose to be the light in the darkness in a variety of ways and places, at home, in public, and online. The modern world often feels fragile and vulnerable, and we cannot afford to be complacent. With growing division in communities across the UK and the world, today more than ever, we must challenge prejudice and the language of hatred. In standing together in Hackney, we must always seek to do what we can to condemn anti-Semitism in all its forms and pledge to tackle division and the spread of identity-based hostility. Indeed, there is no place for prejudice or discrimination against those with any protected characteristic, such as disability, race, religion, belief, or sexual orientation. Let's be clear. Genocide never just happens. There is always a set of circumstances which occur, which create and build that climate where atrocities can take place. Together, today, we gather to learn lessons from the past, to create that safe and better future. Together, we bear witness for those who endured the Holocaust and genocide, and honour the survivors and all those whose lives were changed beyond recognition.
Normally, when we are able to meet in person, we have the privilege in Hackney of hearing from survivors of the Nazi Holocaust. But this year, and in future years, this is going to be less likely because those people are now few in number. So now is the time for us to step up. Yes, to remember them and to be a testament to what they suffered and the worst of humanity. But also to be the light in the darkness in our own community. To challenge racism, sexism, prejudice, hatred and violence, wherever we see it. So I'm challenging you when you leave here today to be the light in the darkness, when you're next hear a casual racist or sexist or homophobic comment. Challenge it. When you see someone being unfairly treated because of who they are, challenge it. And where you see violence or aggression, challenge it if it's safe to do so. Because you can be the beacon of hope, the beacon of fairness, honesty, and anti-violence. And we know how genocide takes its roots. It's when one part of society is somehow separated and treated differently from another. And having visited Rwanda and seen the aftermath of the genocide there, it's scary how easy these bad ideas are to take root. So my challenge to you is, when you leave today, go out and in the next week, the next month, and over the next years, be prepared to be that small light in those small dark moments that we come across on a daily basis, to challenge prejudice, hatred, and violence.
Hello, I'm Detective Chief Superintendent Marcus Barnett, BCU Commander for Hackney and Tower Hamlets Police. We here at Central East BCU are privileged to be invited to attend and contribute to today's significant and most important event. Superintendent Andy Ports will now briefly speak about the commitments our officers in Hackney and indeed across London make to being the light in the darkness.
What an absolute privilege it is to be invited to come together with you all to learn more about the past and work together to create a safer future for everyone. As we all know, the theme for this year is Be the Light in the Darkness. And it certainly made me reflect on the depths humanity can sink to. And I say this even after my own exposure to 25 years of policing London. What we absolutely mustn't forget, though, and what I've had the privilege of seeing in so many ways, is how we work together to resist that darkness. In policing, we work so hard to be the light for so many people. We take hate crime ever so seriously. Whether that be a crime based on a person's race, religion, sexual orientation, disability, or a prejudice against a person who's transgender. Many of you will sadly know about the anti-Semitic graffiti in the north of Hackney just before Christmas. And you will also hopefully know how quickly we mobilised a really strong partnership response in order to identify the suspect, bring him to justice as quickly as possible, and bring an end to these heinous crimes. I'm pleased to say he was promptly detained and arrested, and has been charged with all of these offences. Hopefully this goes some way to show you all how seriously we take hate crime. We remain absolutely committed to working with the community, the London Borough of Hackney, the Shomrim, and other trusted partners to do everything we can to fight hate crime. We deplore any form of hate crime and will do everything in our power to bring to justice those responsible. I want to finish by saying that we in policing in London and here in Hackney and Tower Hamlets stand with you in solidarity against every form of hate crime. Thank you.
My name is Roderick Morris, and I am privileged to be Her Majesty the Queen's representative to the Borough of Hackney. And I am honoured to have been invited to say a few words on this day. It is a day on which we recall the horrors of the evil perpetrated by so-called civilised men on their fellow men. There are now so few who actually experience those horrors. However, it is only by ensuring those experiences are not expunged from our collective memories that we might hope that now and into the future, the marking of this day will reinforce the need for vigilance and moral strength. In looking into the future, we should also acknowledge man's indomitable spirit to make this, our world, a better place for all. And as Her Majesty noted in her Christmas address, we continue to be inspired by the kindness of strangers and draw comfort that even on the darkest nights, there is hope in the new dawn. Thus, if I might paraphrase, let the light and spirit of selflessness love, and above all, hope guide us in the times ahead. Thank you.
My name is Itta Simons, and I'm one of those privileged people to have survived the Holocaust in Poland, where I was born, and furthermore, to make my way with the help of some great people to England. And not only that, but the ability since then to help as many people as I could in any and every possible way.
Good morning, everyone, here from San Francisco, California. I just want to, thank Nicola for organizing this event. I feel so, so grateful to be a part of the Hackney's Holocaust Memorial Day event. It's interesting because y'all's theme is Be the Light in the Darkness. And the last music album that I produced, the title of it was called Singing in the Dark. It's a collection of songs from the Holocaust, and it matches really well with the theme that you guys are doing this year, with to be the light in the darkness. One reason why I recorded these songs from World War II was, as many of you know, so many precious Jewish people and others wrote songs that were a reflection of what they were suffering during the war. But most of those songs were originally written in Yiddish or a different language that not all of us can speak. And I really wanted to make these songs more accessible to the general public. So I produced them in English. So Singing in the Dark is the first and only album of songs from the Holocaust available in English. So I believe you're going to be seeing some of those songs today, and I hope you enjoy listening to them as we remember what happened not so long ago.
Trace. We must keep on hoping we can. To prepare for Holocaust Memorial Day, the Urswick School researched the life of a Hackney man who saved the lives of thousands. The name of this very special person was Rabbi Dr. Solomon Schoenfeld. Jonathan Schoenfeld kindly supported the students as they shone a light on his father's life and work for the local community. Students discovered how Rabbi Schoenfeld saved thousands of people threatened and damaged by the Holocaust in the Second World War. When Hitler and the Nazi Party came to power in Germany, Rabbi Schoenfeld learned of the dangers facing Jews across Europe and soon began to act. Leading the chief rabbi's religious emergency council, he made plans to bring people to safety in Britain. He obtained visas and organized transport. Using his contacts, he found people willing to offer safe homes to Jewish refugees. In 1938, the first among hundreds of Schoenfeld's children arrived as refugees in London.
What was your father's connection to Hackney?
For many years, Stoke Newington was the centre of his life. It was where he was born, went to school, lived and worked. He was the rabbi of a synagogue in Hackney, as well as the principal of a Victor school, named after his father. His office was at 86 Amherst Park, N16. Hackney now has a street named after Rabbi Dr. Solomon Schoenfeld, just around the corner from where he once lived.
What personal qualities made your father achieve his objective so well and save the lives of so many people?
Most importantly, he had a very deep belief in the Almighty and a trust that he was doing his work. Also, he had loads of persuasiveness, determination, energy, imagination, courage, plus he was a brilliant organizer.
How did the children travel to the UK to escape the dangers they faced?
Before the war, he arranged for hundreds of children to come by train and boat from Vienna in Austria to London. They arrived in the UK by sea at Harwich in Essex, and my father would welcome them at Liverpool Street Station, with all the details of where each child would be staying.
Did he help adults, or was it only children?
He also helped many adults escape persecution in their own countries, finding them jobs and homes where they could live safely.
What did he do after the war ended?
He didn't stop. He did everything he could to help survivors of the death camps and other terrible experiences of the Holocaust to rebuild their shattered lives. Often, risking his own life, he travelled to Eastern Europe and personally rescued many survivors whose lives had been destroyed by the Holocaust. The Urswick students wanted to learn more about the sufferings of Schoenfeld's children before they were rescued. They studied the Holocaust story of Bertha Klipstein, one of the children Rabbi Schoenfeld rescued from Poland in 1946. Bertha lived with her family in an elegant Polish city. Before the war, she enjoyed normal, everyday things like swimming, playing with friends, and going to the park. But when she was 12 years old, the war began, and her life, like so many, changed completely. Bertha described the day Poland was invaded.
On the 1st of September, 1939, about 5 o'clock, we heard the first bombs drop. We spent all day in our cellar with lots of other people. We didn't know what it meant, but knew that we had to do something.
They knew that Jews would not be safe when the Nazis were in charge of Poland. So they packed up all they could carry, locked the front door, and just fled. Together with many other Jewish people, they decided to head east towards Russia. The German army advanced behind them. They had no idea what would happen to them. Bertha found that Jews were not welcome in Russia either. They tried to settle, but Russian soldiers came for them. Berta described the next thing that happened.
Lorries came. We were taken to the railway station. 40 people at a time were put into cattle wagons. When we were all in, the doors closed. It was a very hot day, and we didn't get anything to eat.
Over the next weeks, they were sent thousands of miles, all the way across Russia, until they reached Siberia. All the time, Berta and the other Jewish families were starved, crossing Russia on trains and boats. Sometimes they even had to get out and push their train. They all had become infested with lice. Many suffered from jaundice, malaria, dysentery, and typhoid. Berta described the worst part of the journey.
They loaded us onto a barge. It must have had 3,000 people on it. There were no toilets. There were cases of cholera. People fell into the river. Once a day, we used to dock on a riverbank in the middle of nowhere, and that's where they took the corpses off.
Somehow, Berta survived. When the war ended, she was eventually able to return to Poland. She had travelled more than 5,000 miles and been away for over 5 years. As Jews began to return home after the war, from the death camps and the terrors of the Holocaust, Berta found that they were still not welcome. Wherever she went, Berta wanted to study. Although she knew she'd have to move from Poland, she began at college in her hometown, but needed a plan for the future. One day her stepfather heard that a rabbi had come to Poland. He was taking young people to start a new life in England. They added Berta's name to the rabbi's list.
When Rabbi Schoenfeld came, then that was an opportunity to go. And my aunt, who went to work as a domestic for this English Scottish lord in Ayr, she was a contact point. You know, you had, it was very strange because there wasn't a building in Warsaw left except one which was the English embassy, all the embassies, my English-American embassy. And Dr. Schoenfeld got us all in there and he used to hand out little pieces of paper and said, this is the name of your relative and this is the name of your relative. You know, we all had to have relatives there, you know, who were inviting us, which was fictitious, but that was the story then. And we arrived on a Friday morning about 11 o'clock in the port of London. A Tower Bridge opened up and we disembarked into Pickled Herring Street in Bermondsey opposite, you know, the tower, which was very interesting. And then they took us, I think it must have been Norwood somewhere in North London. And all this time when Rabbi Schoenfeld tried to teach us all the songs, he took a table, you know, in the room and put down 86 Amherst Road, which was his office. So we had a contact point wherever we needed something or got lost, you know, we knew where to go.
The students also learned a little about the amazing lives of Lily Stern Polman and her mother. Lily was 9 years old when Poland was invaded. Before the war, Lily had lived with her parents and her little brother, but her father and brother were sent to their deaths. As Jews, Lily and her mother were forced to live in a ghetto. Her mother had to work outside the ghetto. One day she did not come back in time for the curfew, so Lily escaped from the ghetto to find her mother. She expected to be shot at any moment, but the soldiers spared her life. United again with her mother, they were desperate to find somewhere to live. Under the Nazi regime, Jews living outside of the ghetto had no hope of survival. Miraculously, they were kept in hiding by total strangers until the end of the war. The first person to offer them a home was a German civil servant who shared her flat and food with them. Next, a Greek Catholic archbishop and nuns kept them safe. Lily was hidden in an orphanage close to where her mother lived secretly until peace was declared. After the war, they picked up their shattered lives again. When they heard about Rabbi Schoenfeld, 15-year-old Lily did not know whether she could bear to go to England, leaving her mother behind in Poland.
And he hired this Swedish boat. And he transported us on this boat and was going with us for 7 days. In March, it wasn't very nice. A lot of children were very ill. The sea was not very, very calm. And he was marvelous. He was teaching these children to sing because they couldn't communicate with him. I was doing interpreting for him because I spoke German and understood a little bit of English, but nothing to talk about or to converse in. And he spoke some German and Yiddish, and so I managed to translate, to interpret between the children and him. So I was around him all the time, practically, and was I happy to be around him all the time.
And how old were you at that point?
12. Oh, no, what am I saying? No, I was 15.
So this was in which year?
1946. In March 1946, we were sailing, and he was doing everything to have the children's interest. I mean, you know, you had all sorts of children. You had children that were frightened. You had children who never wanted to speak. You had one boy who was a bandit. He was truly dangerous. He had a knife. And if you touched him, you could instantly, because he was in the woods. That's how he saved himself. And he was about 10 years old, 11. He was dangerous, absolutely dangerous. That's that sort of assortment he had. So he decided that he's going to put a blackboard of some sort on it and teach the children to sing. Now, what was he teaching us? Not religious songs, not Hebrew songs, not Yiddish songs, but English songs. Rule Britannia, he would teach us Rule Britannia and explain what it is. He would teach us Daisy Daisy, the little songs like this. He would teach us a song about Abraham who had 1,000 wives, he would say, oh, and sing it. He sang it. And that was the reason why he missed his early breakfast train. He kissed them all goodbye. Things like this, he taught these children. You would never in a million years know this was a rabbi, and yet an ultra-Orthodox one, because it was the means to the end. He was going to save the children no matter how and no matter what. He was eating with us. I won't say. Maybe he didn't need the meat, I don't know. But what did we have on a boat in early 1946, a tiny Swedish boat? They wouldn't have had kosher food, I can't imagine. So he had to eat. And he was sitting with us, eating with us, singing with us, teaching us all sorts of wonderful things. And so for me, Dr. Schoenfeld, God.
Boats sailed from Gdynia
to Tilbury.
Tilbury.
And you can imagine when the Tower of London opened, I mean the bridge, when it opened and we went under. And it opened for us. And that was an amazing sight. An amazing sight at any time. And what more for such children? You know, and he was telling us about the bridge, what it does beforehand. You know, he was just simply amazing. And he was the father to all these children.
On March the 29th, 1946, Berta and Lily both arrived in London on SS Ragney to begin their new lives, thanks to Rabbi Dr. Solomon Schoenfeld. Berta knew no English when she arrived in London. She learned the language as quickly as possible and soon was studying at West Ham Municipal College. Just 5 years later, Berta was awarded an honours degree in chemistry and mathematics by the University of London. On the 3rd of January 1952, it was Rabbi Schoenfeld who performed the ceremony at his Hackney synagogue when Berta married her fellow refugee, Siegfried Klipstein. In the Queen's Birthday Honours List in 2020, Lily Stern Polman was awarded the MBE for services to Holocaust education, awareness, and to human relations. Nearly 40 years after his death, the British government honoured Rabbi Dr. Solomon Schoenfeld by declaring him a British hero of the Holocaust. In making the award, the government recognized his sterling efforts, saved thousands of lives, and clearly demonstrate acts of extraordinary courage.
We're here today to commemorate one of the most terrible events in history, the Holocaust. It was a very dark time for humanity. Jews were being killed, exiled, starved, running away in fear and trepidation. And the whole of Europe, either actively or passively, was involved in this cruelty. Amongst the survivors, there were those who went into their shell, who couldn't cope with the new reality that they had witnessed during the Holocaust. But there were those who managed, thanks God, to come out of this shell and to be a light in darkness, to help others, survivors, refugees, people who had suffered extraordinary pain and suffering, that they should be able to get their lives together. And similarly, Jewish communities in Europe had been decimated, and there were those who helped them to rise from the ashes and to re-establish Jewish life in Europe. I am very fortunate that my parents were the candles in the darkness to bring light to the survivors. Both of them were refugees here in Britain. They had arrived, my mother on a kinder transport in 1938, through the efforts of Rabbi Schoenfeld, and my father in April 39, because his parents were already here and they brought him over. There was young children. My mother was 10 years old. My father was 14 years old. And they experienced life in Britain during the Blitz, during the dark days in the early 40s, where Britain felt endangered to be invaded by the Germans. In 1943, my father joined the British Army and was a participant in the freeing of Italy. And Subsequently, he was one of the soldiers who liberated the infamous concentration death camp Bergen-Belsen. The situation in Bergen-Belsen was beyond anyone's imagination, hell on earth. And the survivors found it very difficult to re-establish their lives. My father felt that one of the greatest services that he had done in his life, thanks God, was to help these survivors resurrect their lives, to get their self-respect back, to find jobs, to rejoin humanity. And he spent a lot of time and took great personal risks in order to facilitate this. And then to help them find places where they'll be able to live in peace and security. He was a young man, he was 20 years old when he did this. But despite his own personal difficulties, being under German Nazi jackboot in 1938, following the annexation of Austria, and then being in Britain during the Blitz, and then having to fight some of the most difficult battles of the Second World War in Italy, he still found the energy and the commitment to help others during this dark time. A light in the darkness. My mother, similarly, she was a young woman when refugees came from Europe in 1945, young people, they were known as the boys, and she really committed herself, despite being an orphan, despite being a young refugee herself, to help these people bring their lives together. Today we face a dark time as well. Not as dark as during the Holocaust, but dark enough. And many of us feel challenged. We feel, what can we do during this period when thousands of people in Britain and millions of people around the world are dying? COVID-19 is our challenge. We have to be a light in this darkness. And we can draw inspiration from people like my father and my mother, who, during the darkest of times, managed to bring light, strength, happiness, hope into the lives of so many. In Hackney today, we are faced with challenges. May their lives serve as an inspiration from which we can draw courage, please God, to help others in our borough at this time. My best wishes to you all.
Good morning and welcome. I'm a sixth form student at Hagson School, a beacon school for Holocaust education. We study the Holocaust in the curriculum lower down the school, and we study it as the focus of our coursework at A level. We had a workshop planned as part of this project, but now that the school is closed, we are pleased to be involved remotely. We will now give a brief introduction, which will be followed by a presentation on surviving the Holocaust. Shahava Khan and her parents were taken from their home in Holland to the Bergen-Belsen concentration camp when she was just 8 years old. Shahava rarely spoke about her traumatic childhood and how she survived more than a year of starvation and disease. All that changed in 2001 when her mother, Rosie Kanarek, died and she discovered a tiny suitcase tucked away in her cupboard. The contents of this suitcase proved to be a remarkable archive of one family's Holocaust experience, a trove of perfectly preserved original documents, photographs and letters.
Zahava's daughter, Hepzibah Rudolfsky, on seeing the suitcase, encouraged her mother to share her experiences in the camp for the first time. Zahava and Hepzibah, many years after the liberation of the Bergen-Belsen concentration camp, have worked extensively in schools, sharing how finding the artifacts has impacted their relationship and has sparked their project, Surviving the Holocaust. Hepzibah said, "My mother's story is extraordinary and uplifting, a story of courage, positivity, dignity and strength, full of hope and living life to the full, and showing the spirit of resilience, a phenomenal message for all future generations. A book, Fragments of a Lost Childhood, Zahava Khan in conversation with Anne Rosen, captures the story based on the contents of the suitcase." As Stephen Smith, founder of the UK Holocaust Centre, says, "The story of Zahava's journey from Palestine to Amsterdam and the concentration camps of Westerbork and Bergen-Belsen, and from persecution to survival, had never been told before. It is a remarkable and deeply moving story. But what makes it very special is the amazing wealth of personal letters and documents preserved by Zahava's mother. The pieces of the jigsaw that gradually fall into place as the story unfolds."
I am honoured and delighted to participate in the London Borough of Hackney's Holocaust Memorial Day ceremony. Thank you for this special invitation. Today I'm going to tell you a short story of the Kanarek family, an ordinary family who were caught up in the horrors of the Second World War. My mother's parents, Rosie and Zygmunt, were born in Poland. They met in Germany in 1932 and married later that year. They had two children, Zahava and Yehudi. From 1933, Nazi Germany passed increasingly anti-Semitic laws. Zahava's parents decided to leave Germany for Palestine in 1935, which at that time was under British control. Zahava was born in Palestine in August 1935. But Rosie and Zygmunt found the move from Germany to Palestine very challenging. The heat was a particular problem for Rosie, and she became very unwell. So unwell that the doctors advised them to return to Europe. They left Palestine in April 1937 and moved to Amsterdam, unaware of the irony that they were returning to Europe for health reasons. From the age of four, Zahava went to a Jewish nursery school, and from there she went on to a Jewish primary school. And then disaster struck. Germany invaded Holland on the 10th of May 1940. From then on, life became increasingly difficult for Dutch Jews. There were restrictions on all aspects of daily life. In April 1942, the Nazis ordered that all Dutch Jews had to wear a yellow Star of David on their outer clothing to identify them as Jews. And then, in the midst of all this, in August 1941, Zahava's brother Yehudi was born. Rosie and Zygmunt were desperate to escape from Holland, but they faced many obstacles. Travel was severely restricted, there were curfews at night, and they were no longer allowed to use public transport. The only way to escape out of Amsterdam would be to be smuggled out under the cover of night. However, this would be risky, there was a small baby who might cry or make a noise. They would all be found out. So, in December 1942, when Yehudi was just 16 months old, Rosie and Zygmunt took a very difficult decision. They decided to hand baby Yehudi to the Dutch resistance to try and ensure his safety.
He was then taken through my father's work. They had contact with somebody who was a non-Jewish lady who was working for the resistance. And she was the lady who was instrumental in finding a place for my brother to be hidden. And also, he was very blonde, blue-eyed, so they thought that would be very much easier than with me, being very dark-haired and dark eyes, so they didn't even think about me being hidden. But he was then sent to people out of Amsterdam, and I was told that whoever was going to ask me what had happened to my brother, because the people who knew my parents, they wouldn't have asked, they knew what had happened. But people who didn't know him, I had to say that we had lost him somewhere on the way.
Rosie and Zygmunt were still desperately trying to escape from Holland. They managed to get papers in April 1943 for Honduras citizenship, a country in Central America. These papers were legitimate, but they just arrived too late as the borders were now closed. Fate was closing in on Zahava's family. The Germans were deporting Jews en masse to extermination and concentration camps around Europe. On the 26th of May 1943, the SS came for Zahava and her parents. They were sent to Westerbork in northeast Holland. Westerbork served as a transit camp for Jews who had been deported from the Netherlands to Eastern Europe. Rosie and Zygmunt both had jobs in Westerbork. We have their work cards on the screen. There was a transport from Westerbork to extermination camps every Tuesday. The lists were put up each Monday evening. 4 months after they arrived at Westerbork, Zahava and her parents were informed that they were being sent to Auschwitz on the transport the following morning. The next morning, they gathered at the train station. The platform was crowded with people, including SS soldiers and vicious barking dogs. There was a sense of fear and foreboding.
On that one Monday night where the papers always called for Tuesday transport to Bergen-Belsen, to Auschwitz, sorry. And on that Monday night when our names were on the list to go the next day to Bergen, to Auschwitz, my parents couldn't believe it because they had been told all the time that we were not going to be sent off, that we were going to be exchanged. And so my parents got their stuff, whatever we had could take, together. And I do also remember one other thing. Every Monday night, all the cattle carts came to the station. And there were always about two or three normal carriages. And I was suffering slightly of asthma. And I said to my mother, both my parents, can we please go a bit early? When I heard that we were going on the train, which before then we had been told all the time, no transport for us. So I said, can we go a little bit early the next morning that we get a seat on one of the normal carriages, not knowing that that was for the SS. So my mother had to explain that to me, that we couldn't go on one of those carriages. And literally the last minute before going onto that cattle cart, my parents had tried to organize that we were going with friends of theirs in the same cattle cart because they were so taken aback that we were going to go be sent to Auschwitz. And somebody said, this is family Kanarek. And the chap came to my parents and said, I wish I had a message like this for more people as I've got for you. You've been taken off this transport. And my parents just couldn't believe it. And literally, had he come a minute later, we would have been on one of the cattle carts. Nobody would have known where.
And I wouldn't be telling you this story today. They returned to the barracks and stayed in Westerbork for a further 5 months. Once, Rosie received a bag of raw beans through the post. She was puzzled. Why would a stranger send her a bag of raw beans? There were no cooking facilities. And even though she couldn't use them, she sifted through that little bag, and there, hidden among the beans, she discovered a small photograph of her son, Yehudi. The people looking after her son had somehow managed to send this photo to her to let her know that her little boy was still alive and well. Rosie managed to keep this photo throughout their ordeal, and for her it became a symbol of hope. In January 1944, Zahava and her parents were selected to be sent to Bergen-Belsen, a concentration camp near Hanover in northwest Germany. While Bergen-Belsen contained no gas chambers, approximately 50,000 people died of starvation, overwork, disease, brutality, and as a result of sadistic medical experiments. How did they exist? The thousands of prisoners lived in wooden barracks which were overflowing with people. The barracks were freezing in the winter and stifling in the summer. Each day started off with the appel. These roll calls were an overriding memory for Zahava.
Standing for hours and hours on end on the roll call, and they were playing games and saying somebody was missing, which it wasn't. It was just they wanted to keep us longer and longer standing in the most horrible condition.
Roll calls took place outside early in the morning in all weather conditions, snow, rain, and the oppressive summer heat. It lasted for hours on end. It was a scary time for the prisoners. What were the prisoners given to eat?
In the morning, a crust of stale bread, and that had to last until the evening. And some liquid, which they called coffee, coloured substance. And then in the evening, they gave something which they called a kind of soup or vegetables with turnips and water, and that was the dinner. And that didn't even always arrive. And because sometimes there were bombings or so going on, so they left that out of our hands. But I find it even difficult now to think how people, how parents managed.
Many went mad with hunger. Tens of thousands died from starvation. In Bergen-Belsen, Rosie worked as a cleaner for the SS commandant, and Sigmund worked in the shoe commando. It was filthy work and the conditions were grueling. Sigmund's teeth were knocked out by an SS guard. Who knows why? He never spoke about it. Zahava did not have any possessions with her. She would just lie on her bunk, by now in an enfeebled state, starving and ill, just waiting for her mother to return from work. Sanitation was almost non-existent. There were hardly any toilets or washing facilities for the tens of thousands of prisoners. Instead, most inmates used tin pots in the barracks as their toilets, which meant there was a constant stench of excrement. Disease was rampant, mainly in the form of typhus and dysentery, both of which were hugely contagious. There was no medical treatment for the sick. It is remarkable how the Canarets had survived for this long, as the average life expectancy of an inmate could be measured in weeks. By the end of 1944, the Canarets had been in Bergen-Belsen for 11 months, and their health was deteriorating by the day. They were desperately ill. On the 21st of January 1945, the Canarets were told they were being removed from Bergen-Belsen. It's unlikely the Canarets would have survived for many more days under these horrendous conditions. This was the height of the typhus epidemic at Bergen-Belsen. When Zahava was released from Bergen-Belsen, aged 9 and a half, she weighed 3 stone. They were placed in a Red Cross transport and taken to a hostel in Weingarten in Germany, and a few days later they were taken by train to Biberach, a large internment camp on the German-Swiss border. Biberach was liberated by the French on the 23rd of April 1945. And then, 6 weeks later, in June 1945, Zahava's grandparents in Zurich received a historic orange card celebrating Holland's liberation from Germany from Annie Rodenburg, the contact in the Dutch resistance. In the short note, Annie Rodenburg tells Zahava's grandparents that their grandson, Yehudi, is alive and well. But even though the war was over, there was chaos. The Canarets were amongst thousands of displaced people who had been made destitute by the Germans. Fortunately, they had family in Zurich, and so they were able to travel there in the summer of 1945. Most displaced persons who did not have family faced years in internment camps following the war. Zygmunt sent a telegram dated the 23rd of July to Annie Rodenberg asking after Yehudi. And the reply he received from her dated the 3rd of August states the following: "Child, quite well." Zygmunt returned to Amsterdam by himself in November 1945. He was intent on re-establishing himself so he could support the family upon their eventual return. They had been left with nothing following the war. No home, no possessions, and of course, no livelihood. He was temporarily united with Yehudi, who was now 4 years old. But Zygmunt was in no position to look after Yehudi, so it was arranged that Yehudi went to live with a cousin of Rosie in Sweden. Zahava and Rosie were still too weak and ill to return to Amsterdam, so they remained in Switzerland for another year, during which time they underwent medical treatment for severe malnutrition and other illnesses. Whilst in Zurich, Zahava went to school from time to time. It was only in November 1946, nearly 20 months after the war, that Zahava and Rosie finally returned to Amsterdam. And soon after, they made the journey to Sweden, when they were finally reunited with Yehudi in Stockholm. Rosie hadn't seen her son Yehudi for 4 years, since he was just a 16-month-old toddler. Now he was 5 and a half. Can you imagine the sense of relief and joy when Rosie was reunited with Yehudi? But the reaction she received from Yehudi wasn't what she had wished for. Yehudi didn't want to know Rosie. He was happy and settled with his new family, his new parents and siblings. And now he's faced with another woman claiming to be his mother. It was all very confusing for him. After several weeks in Stockholm, and only when Rosie felt that she had sufficiently bonded with Yehudi, did they return to Amsterdam, where Zygmunt was waiting for them. The Canarets began the process of adjusting to family life and reuniting a broken family. Yehudi and Zahava returned to the Jewish secondary school in Amsterdam. Every child in this photograph has either survived the camps or had been in hiding. Can you imagine the stories behind each of these children? Everyone had a story. You may be wondering if Rosie and Zygmunt spoke to Zahava about their experiences in the camps.
I do remember whenever I or my brother came into the living room and they were entertaining, they always changed the subject immediately. They didn't want us to go on worrying about what had happened, and because they had seen the results of some of the children who were suffering from their experiences before, and they didn't want that. They wanted us to look ahead.
What was Zahava's parents' attitude to life after the war?
In spite of all the terrible things that had happened, my mother's sister having been killed, and but still they were looking ahead and trying, and many of their friends hadn't survived, but still they were looking ahead. And I think also mainly to us as children, to give us a positive kind of feeling that we shouldn't worry about all the things that we had passed.
In 1958, Zahava moved to London, where she started working as a teacher. She continued to visit her parents in Holland when possible. In August 1962, while visiting her parents on holiday in Holland, Zahava met a young British pharmacologist. She married this young man, German-born Ralph Kohn, in March 1963. Zahava and Ralph lived in London, where they had 3 daughters, and 5 grandchildren. I'm the eldest daughter. So what happened to Yehudi? After university, Yehudi moved to Israel, where he joined the diplomatic service. He held posts in Germany, the USA, and Canada. His final post was as Israeli ambassador to Belgium and Luxembourg. He is married with 2 children and 2 grandchildren. He is now retired and lives in Israel and is in close touch with Zahava. Where is home?
Home is here. And I'm very lucky. I've got all my three children here with their families, and we very much enjoy that we are in regular contact, and we have got a wonderful relationship with them, and it's very happy.
Sigmund passed away in 1976. He never recovered physically after his ordeal during the war, and he never spoke about his experiences in the camps. Rosie lived in Holland until the age of 87, when she emigrated to Israel. Despite or maybe because of her experiences, she was an exceptionally robust, strong-willed woman. She died in 2001 at the age of 95. Zahava was and is devoted to her family. She has also been involved in much community and charitable work over the years. When we were growing up, Zahava never spoke of her childhood experiences. However, this changed after Rosie's death. After Zahava discovered the bag containing these photographs and documents, some of which you've seen today, Zahava started to talk about this period of her life, and it culminated in her writing her memoir, Fragments of a Lost Childhood. For the past 11 years, through our school's programme, Zahava and I have been sharing her story with school children of all backgrounds and faiths throughout the United Kingdom and also in Germany. And now I'm doing this with you today. In October 2020, Zahava was awarded an MBE for her work in Holocaust education. Despite our outreach work and that of many other Holocaust survivors, a study published in 2019 by the Holocaust Memorial Day Trust revealed that millions of Britons do not believe the Holocaust took place. Still. So, why is this such a remarkable story? Behind many stories of survival in the Holocaust lie miracles of good luck and fortune. But alongside this, in the case of Zahava's family, I think it was also about attitude. The Kanarak family acted with courage, positivity, dignity, and strength. Does Zahava have any message for you?
Just to try to be positive and to try to help people if you can. And, you know, not whether you've got a different religion or so, you shouldn't look at that. You should look at the person, what their qualities are and what their way of dealing with other people is, and try to lead it that way. And not to go because you're being told you've got this religion or that religion, that shouldn't come into it.
The theme for Holocaust Memorial Day this year is Be the Light in the Darkness. How fitting. After all the darkness Zahava and her family endured during the war, she has been a beacon of light for our family and the wider community, with her positive attitude, kindness and compassion, a radiant star of hope and a shining light to come out of one of the darkest periods in history. I hope you think so too.
Holocaust Memorial Day was established on the 27th of January 2000, when representatives from 46 countries around the world met in Stockholm to discuss Holocaust education, remembrance and research. At the end of this meeting, all attendees signed a declaration committing to preserving the memory of those who were murdered in the Holocaust.
We recognise that the Holocaust shook the foundations of modern civilization. Its unprecedented character and horror will always hold universal meaning.
We believe the Holocaust must have a permanent place in our nation's collective memory. We honour the survivors still with us and reaffirm our shared goals of mutual understanding and justice.
We must make sure that future generations understand the causes of the Holocaust and reflect upon its consequences. We vow to remember the victims of Nazi persecution and of all genocide.
We value the sacrifices of those who have risked their lives to protect or rescue victims as a touchstone of the human capacity for good in the face of evil.
We recognize
that humanity is still scarred by the belief that race, religion, disability or sexuality make some people's lives worth less than others. Genocide, anti-Semitism, racism, xenophobia and discrimination still continue. We have a shared responsibility to fight these evils.
We pledge to strengthen our efforts to promote education and research about the Holocaust and other genocides. We will do our utmost to make sure that the lessons of such events are fully learned.
We will continue to encourage Holocaust Remembrance Day by holding an annual UK Holocaust Memorial Day. We condemn the evils of prejudice, discrimination, and racism. We value a free, tolerant, and democratic society.
This is the prayer, the memorial prayer, the Lord of Compassion.
El mole rachamim, shoychein bameroimim, mazhirim es nishmois kolelo shenergo vishenechneku vishenisrefu bemilchomois horishoin vahasheini vishar milchomois. Oh no, Balorachamim, Yastireihem, Viseisek no fov leolomim, Vitroim, Vitroi Rachayim, Esnish Mosom, Hashemu Nachalosom. Yenuchu b'sholoim al mishkavom v'nemar amen.
We thank you and all contributors for your commitment to remember victims of the Holocaust and subsequent genocide and to honoring their memories. Please reflect on the stark, powerful, and bravely shared testimony you have heard today and rise to the call to action to be the light in the darkness. We all share a responsibility to strive for a safer, better future for everyone in Hackney. This includes tackling prejudice, discrimination, and intolerance wherever we encounter this. Together at a time when the world feels fragile and divided, we can all stand in solidarity, showing the very best of which humanity is capable. Through our prayers and actions, help us to stand together with those who are suffering, so that light may banish all darkness, love will prevail over it, and good will triumph over evil. Stop.